1340 WJOL presents A Rich Conversation with Rich Renick. No politics, no controversy. Just the lively art of conversation about interesting people in our world. Here's Rich Renick.
As our day continues, remember that no act of kindness, no matter how small, is ever wasted. Hi, hello, how are you? And welcome to A Rich Conversation. I'm Rich Renick. No politics, no controversy, just the lively art of conversation. And today, our conversation is going to be with an incredibly talented young man from Ireland. He's a repeat guest here on A Rich Conversation, Neil Byrne.
Someone's knocking at the door. Somebody's ringing the bell. Someone's knocking at the door. Somebody's ringing the bell. Do me a favor. Open the door and let me in.
Well, hello, Rich. How are you?
I am doing very well now that we've connected. I didn't realize the amount of numbers we had to dial to connect in Ireland, but it was well worth it. My finger is going to recover in about 15 minutes.
I know. You wouldn't want to have to memorize it, that's for sure.
Neil Byrne is one of the principals of an iconic Irish show group, Celtic Thunder. It's a name you're certainly familiar with. Neil, your involvement with Celtic Thunder goes back to pretty much the very beginning, didn't it?
It certainly does, Rich. God, when I think about it now, it's frightening when I say it's over 15 years ago now. It's incredible. Yeah, I became part of the Celtic Thunder show as the guitar player. I came into the show with the then musical director, Phil Coulter. I was playing guitar in his band. And yeah, it was just, you know, it's like these many of these things, you know, it was just by chance and, you know, luck, a lot of luck now that I look at it now, you know, the years I've got out of it and what's come of it all. But yeah, 15 years. So guitar player in the beginning, and I used to record a lot of the backing vocals and stuff like that for the show as well in studio that went on some of the albums. And then because the producer and the musical director kind of knew my voice then very well, luckily enough, they kind of liked something in the voice. So they asked me to sing a solo track on the next show, the second show called Heritage. And it was a funny, you know, story about that. The song that they actually picked for me was a song that Phil Coulter wrote. And he wrote it for Liam Neeson and Natasha Richardson, God rest her, for their wedding. And it was an instrumental song, and then he put a lyric to it for me to sing it on the Celtic Thunder show. That was a song called Noreen.
When I dream, I'll be dreaming of Noreen.
And then the following year I became one of the principal singers in the show, and since then, they just can't get rid of me, you know? I've just been in the, you know, I'm having too much of a good time with Celtic Thunder. It's always been fantastic, you know? Always been a really, really great experience, and playing in all the fantastic theatres and all in the States. It's been just amazing, you know?
So your involvement with Celtic Thunder, you really didn't have to audition then for it, did you?
I didn't. I got away lightly. I kind of got in the back door, if you like, you know. I didn't have to audition, no. So it was just by chance, you know, getting in there. And I really loved it, you know. It was kind of my first time on the big stage. I'd done a little bit. I'd done a tour with Phil Coulter and his band for about a month in the States a year beforehand. I was actually playing bass guitar for him. And but on this show, you know, we were going out and we were playing to, God, within the first 2 weeks of the first tour, we were in Radio City for two nights and packed out audience, like, I think 6,500 or 7,000 people. I remember I was a nervous wreck at the same time, but it was pretty incredible, you know, to be playing in one of the most iconic venues in the world. Mm-hmm. And, you know, from when I really think about it, a year previous, you know, I was playing at weddings and dinner dances and some pubs and stuff like that, which was nothing wrong with it. I was making a living from it, and it was great. But this was a huge, huge step up, you know. So, it's incredible to say that was so long ago now, you know.
Now, and your involvement with Phil Coulter. Now, Phil Coulter is a legendary name in Ireland. And the fact that you played with him, how did that even come about as a young musician, linking up with a legendary songwriter and performer like Phil Coulter?
Yeah, well, you know, it actually came from a good friend of mine that had a functions band, and I used to play with him quite regularly. And he was a soccer coach, and he used to train Phil's son. And Phil approached Josh, his name, the guy, approached Josh and says, I'm looking for one guy or two guys to play at my daughter's 21st birthday in the house. And I just basically lived around the corner from where Phil was, you know. And it's funny, growing up, I remember my dad saying to me, see that house there across the road? That's where Phil Coulter lives. He owns that house there, you know. He's a very famous songwriter. And I thought, looking up to him in that way. And I played in his house. And sure, Phil got up and Phil played half the night with us as well. And then he asked me to go and play on a cruise with him. And so I did that, and I did a couple of years of quite a number of years of the cruise, the Phil Coulter cruise. And then, as I said, I'd done a tour with Phil as well, and that led to Celtic Thunder. So it was kind of all these little stepping stones, you know, that led to Celtic Thunder. And Phil was with us for the first few years, you know, and there was some of his amazing, you know, compositions in the show, and still are. So, yeah, that's how it happened. And I just can't believe, you know, when I look back before the 15 years in Celtic Thunder, it seems like another life, if you like, you know what I mean?
Yes.
It's how things have changed dramatically, you know, in those years. But that was my path into the show, you know. It's crazy how life can just take these twists and bends, and you're just hoping and that you get a bit of luck when you turn around another bend and maybe something will be there for you, you know. And especially as a musician, it really needs to be like that, you know.
Now, as a musician, Neil, the dark 2 years that we encountered through the pandemic really altered a lot of careers. And it caused a lot of people to take a look at what can I do with the career path that I've chosen. And when that came up, you stayed with Celtic Thunder, but there wasn't a lot of work for Celtic Thunder. So you branched out and teamed up with another member of Celtic Thunder.
Yeah, well, I mean, myself, Bryne and Kelly, myself and Ryan are going 10 years now, and we've had a great time of it as well. We're doing, you know, smaller gigs, smaller theatres, art centres, and we've had an amazing time over the last 10 years as a duo. It's been really great. But yeah, when the I'll give you a story about what happened when the pandemic, when it all started to kick off, we had a tour of Bryne and Kelly in the States. And we were starting in Houston, Texas. And we had 2 days rehearsal while we were there. And it was all on the news. It was beginning to spread a little bit, getting a little bit worrying. We had a 6-week tour. And then on the second day of rehearsal, we seen on the news that they were thinking of shutting the airport down in the States. I was going, oh my God. So we basically took the PA system down and packed our bags, and we had to leave town to get out and get back to Ireland before we couldn't, you know, that way. So we were really guessing. We didn't know what was happening, but we knew at that stage they were starting, you know, to kind of shut down the likes of venues and big gatherings. So we said, okay, this isn't going to happen. So that's what happened there. But it's funny, Rich, the pandemic for me, yet again, musicians, it hit us hard. Absolutely. And not only musicians, you know, across the board, but it took a long, long time for musicians to get it back out and work again. I remember my daughter was born the Christmas just before the pandemic kind of kicked off. So it was only a couple of months before the pandemic kicked off. So when I was back here, and I live in Wexford, and I'm near the coastline here and the mountains as well. So it's a lovely picturesque place. We were lucky that even on lockdown, we were able to get up around the trails and the hills and down towards the sea and all that. So, and with my little daughter as well, only born, my first daughter, when I look back on it, was a little bit of a, you know, it was a special time for myself and my partner, Nicole, and to have our little child, that we were spending so much time with her. In that sense, and out for Ireland, we had really good weather, which was crazy. But we were kind of blessed in that sense. But for the likes of the creative end of it, it really did something for me. And I think for my songwriting, it created something new for me. And I suppose for me, if you explain this right, songwriting, I used to go into a room, kind of blank canvas, and try to write a song, see what I could come up with. If I did, I did. Great. If I didn't, I didn't. But it was tough doing it like that. But the pandemic allowed me to kind of slow up. I'd no distractions. And basically, I was doing, you know, a lot of reading, and even studied my ancestry and all that type of thing, a lot of history. And when I came across a story or something, even got to do with my family, which I did, a couple of them, that really blew me away. I wanted to address that story with some music. That's how I would put it. So now songwriting for me that came out of the pandemic was basically when I come across a really interesting story, I dress it up with music, and that's how I write a song now. And I really, really love doing it that way. And I don't think I'd ever go back to doing it the old way I used to do. So the pandemic for me had major setbacks in a financial sense, like it did for us all. But at the same time, in a creative way, it really opened up a big, big door for me in that sense. And I've never looked back in that way, you know. So it had its kind of pros and cons for me.
Now, with the group of Celtic Thunder, when you folks were together and you were touring, that was the venue for exposing the music because you had a live audience. And of course, now with things, how they've changed, you had to look at getting your music heard in a different way. What was that way that you chose to follow?
Yeah, I mean, you know, online now, as you know, there's quite a number of different platforms that you can, you know, you could do a live show or a live gig on. I only did one not so long ago on Vimeo. With Celtic Thunder, we decided to start filming while we were kind of, it was when lockdown was loosening up, but musicians certainly weren't getting back to work, you know. There was no gatherings like that in enclosed areas. So we started what was called the Home Series. And we were filming around Ireland. We were filming about, you know, a lot of history, myths and legends, our ancestry, as I was talking about earlier. Lots of different topics, great actors, iconic films. I suppose people, a lot of people are fans across the world. They were at home and stuck in. And when we did this, they were really happy to be in contact with us. But for us to be hosting these new shows was new. They were getting to see Ireland. They were getting to see a really interesting topic. We were interviewing a lot of interesting people. So it really, really worked great. And we were putting a lot of our music into it at the same time. And since then, we've kept it going. We do something like that every 3 months or so. And we've kept the home series is still going now, the Celtic Thunder home series. So that was a really positive thing that came out of it as well, using those platforms. Now, having said that, thank God, like last year, we went out on the Celtic Thunder. We went out last March and we did a North American tour, and it was fantastic. We got huge crowds because I think people just wanted to go out and see a show again, you know. People were starting to kind of loosen the strings again and just get out and try to enjoy themselves. We're just after recording a brand new album. It's getting mixed now, you know, Celtic Thunder. And we're touring in the fall. So all is good, you know, in that sense. You know, we were very, very lucky. And I consider myself very, very lucky during that time that we had that outlet as well. And as I said, it worked out kind of so well that we kept it going, you know, alongside the music.
You're listening to A Rich Conversation. I'm Rich Renick. My guest today is Neil Byrne, one of the principal performers of Celtic Thunder and half of the duo of Byrne and Kelly. Now, Neil, with the talent that you exude, you with your singing, the guitar work, it had to start somewhere. Now, you were born into a musical family with your dad, Eddie.
That's right, Rich. Yeah, my dad, like myself, since he was a kid, he was a guitar player and singer, you know. And he was just great for me. You know, he was just always such, my dad passed away 5 years ago, and he was just such a lovely, I'm very, very lucky to be able to say my dad was the kindest man I've ever known. He always put everybody else before him and made everybody feel at home, even when he was just talking to them, you know. He was just such a great character like that. But as a musician as well, he was such a hearty musician, just loved great music, and he played, you know, his whole life. That's what he'd done. And it was great from the age, oh God, when I started off, I was only, you know, I don't know, 7 or 8 years of age, with guitar. Great role model. And then he brought me as a child to one of his rehearsals in Dublin. And I just thought this was absolutely magical. Absolutely magical. And I was hooked from then on in. And from the age of 13, I think it was, I started to go along to my dad's gigs and play with his band. So I got a lot of experience at a very, very young age of playing in a professional band, even though for half of it, I didn't know what I was doing. But I was, behind my dad's shield, if you like, you know, standing beside him. But I was getting so much from them and these guys that were professional. And then I'd practice day and night and day and night and day and night. And of course, my dad could hear me getting improving all the time and all the time. And he loved that fact as well, you know. And and then from the age of 14, I was playing with them a lot. 15, my dad became semi-retired. He actually did retire at that stage, and I took over from him. So I was playing in a professional band by the age of 15. You know, I used to do the odd little bit of writing music with my dad. He was great. He had such great knowledge of melody and chords. And I'd go to him maybe with an idea of a song, and he'd tell me where to go. And he'd say, this needs a bit of a lift at the end. Put a key change in there, you know, or a nice little rall at the end of that, you know. He just knew from all his experience, he was able to guide me in a very, very positive way, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you know, I'm very, very lucky to have the best memories. I really do have priceless memories with him, you know.
And of course, the memories include that beautiful song that your dad sang, in which you and Nicole did the backup vocals.
Oh, yes, yes, yes. In my life, the Beatles.
There are places I remember all my life, though some have changed, some forever, not for better. Some have gone and some remain. No, I'll often stop and think about them. In my life, I love you more. Affection for people and things that went before, I love you more.
My dad was always a huge fan of the Beatles, you know, and their songwriting and George Martin and all, you know, that whole universe was just wonderful. My dad knew all the songs inside out from playing them for years and years and years, you know, along with everything else. But we did really enjoy that. I would have liked to have had more recordings with my dad, you know. We did that recording when my dad was diagnosed with dementia, and we got into the studio and we said, come on, let's do something. And in fairness to him, like, I remember my poor dad, he had to read the words, but he had absolutely no problem kind of playing the guitar, and pitching the vocal was perfect, even though the memory was really going at that stage and all, you know. But I'm delighted we actually decided to do that, because we have a lovely vocal on that and his guitar playing on that song, which is always great to have, you know. I just wish we had it done more years before, but sure, that's always the way, you know.
Yeah,
but that's a precious 3 minutes of that song, you know.
All right, Neil Byrne, you started out with Celtic Thunder, which was a big organization. Then you went to Byrne and Kelly as a duo, and now you're a solo act. It's kind of going down from Celtic Thunder to Byrne and Kelly, now to Neil Byrne's.
Yeah. Well, you know, Rich, I know. It's funny. I was only saying to my partner the other day, Nicole, I was saying, you know, I said once there was 35 people with three Nashville coaches and three trucks and trailers full of gear. That went to five people in a van, and it's below me in a car, you know. But you know what? You know, it's amazing. It's funny how things work out, you know. What I'm doing now as a solo artist as well, I'm really excited about, because every bit of, I suppose, influence I've got through the years, every bit of experience on the stage through all from my dad's band right up to listening to all the greats. I always loved all the American bands and all, including like Billy Joel and, you know, even down to crossing Canadian bands and all the best. All that experience and songwriting has gone into the set list I have for my upcoming tour. So I'm really excited about it, because I feel it's all kind of come together for me down into this gig that I'm playing by myself. You know, I'll be honest with you. I'm nervous about it because it's new. It's a challenge. But at the same time, I can't wait to get out in front of an audience and go, hey, this is my universe. This is what I'm doing. You know, there's songs in there that people would have heard before. There's quite a number of new compositions, new stories to tell. And I think behind every song that I do, there is quite an intriguing story behind them, you know. Mm-hmm. That's the model of what I do now. So, yeah, I'm really, really excited about it, you know. It's just great, Rich, to kind of, I think it's the right time for me to do it. I don't think I would have had as much experience, you know, going back a few years ago to put a show of my own together that I think I can do now, you know, to entertain and put the right colors in it and know how to make a show travel the correct way and put the right colors into it, you know. So, yeah, I'm really, really looking forward to it, you know.
Now, your debut solo film project, you call it Here Art Thou. And it's available on Vimeo, and it's just an incredible performance, Neil. There's no question about it. With what you do as a solo performer, you'd be hard-pressed to know that you're doing this all by yourself, and you're using the technique of looping, and you have mastered that. Describe what that process is.
Well, yeah, looping, yeah. It's, Rich, for starters, like, it's nice to hear, you know, a show with somebody singing and playing guitar. Sometimes I can find that very monotone, and maybe from after an hour, I think it can get a little bit heavy on the ears. That's just for me. So I like to put as much color into a show, into a gig, to give people something else that's coming in here, coming out. It's like a song that is playing for 4 minutes. Somewhere in the middle, it needs to go somewhere else, for people to enjoy the journey of that song. And I find it the same with a show. So basically what I'm doing, obviously on stage, it's just myself and my guitar, but I use a couple of techniques where I'll be introducing different colors throughout a song, or setting up a song with maybe a percussion track. And what I do is I play the percussion off tapping the body of the guitar. I loop that with a pedal that keeps going. And I might play a couple of little notes high on the guitar, loop that goes through. And I play the bass lines through while I'm picking the guitar as well. And sometimes I have a little microphone fitted in the inside of the body of the guitar, which I sing into sometimes. And I loop up a couple of harmonies, maybe somewhere in the song or on the outro of the song. And that will play back a kind of a ghostly type of harmony phrase, and sing the song through. Now, I don't do this with all the songs by any means. You know, some songs have just been myself. It's just guitar and myself. Other songs, I have some pedals that I create a kind of a nice pad. It's like a couple of violins or something like that that are just keeping this lovely warm note going underneath the music, you know. Just different things like that. So I always tend to think of them as colours. And it's like different colours coming in at different times. They're subtle, but they come in at different times and they just add texture to the sound. They add character to the sound. And I really enjoy building sometimes little productions live while I'm playing it, you know.
Yeah.
So that's kind of the model of the gig. And as I said, every song has quite an intriguing backstory to it. I use that instrumentation to paint a picture as well, you know. So that's my whole idea behind it all. And that's what people would see if they came to a Neil Byrne show. That's the model, you know.
Yes. Now, the project is called Here Art Thou. And you could look at and listen to 10 songs that are fantastically performed by Neil Byrne. How do we get that? How do we get the Vimeo version of that?
Well, if you were to go on to neilbyrnemusic.com, you will see on the page there, it'll show you the sizzle reel, you know, it's a little trailer of the movie itself. And there's a link to Vimeo. It'll bring you onto Vimeo and you can either purchase the actual concert itself or you can rent it. So there's two options there.
Mm-hmm.
So that's basically how to access it. You know, so it's neilbyrnemusic.com.
neilbyrnemusic.com. And also, while we were talking about In My Life, the song that was performed by your dad, Eddie, and you and Nicole performing backup vocals for that, you did that with the express intent of raising awareness and also raising some money for the Irish Alzheimer's Foundation. So you can purchase that, and that money goes to a very good cause.
That's very true. That's very true, Rich. And people have been really, really great. The few years we've collected a great sum of money, and the Dementia Association in Wicklow have been absolutely amazing. You know, they do incredible work. When my dad was really ill, they come to the house every day, three times a day, and they help out with everything. They're absolutely wonderful, you know. They're angels and saints. They really are.
Yes.
I like to kind of help out that way as much as possible, you know.
And we can get that information on neilbyrnemusic.com also?
Absolutely, Rich. Absolutely. That will be on the same site there.
There you go. The name of the project is Here Art Thou. The artist is Neil Byrne. Going to be making his way across the ocean to the United States in a little while. And you can follow Neil on neilbyrnemusic.com.
And the tour dates are there as well.
And there you go. And thank you so much, Neil, for being here.
Thank you so much, Rich. I really appreciate it.
Please mark your calendar for 1 week from today for another Rich Conversation. I'm Rich Renick, and thank you for making us a part of your day.